The transport layer is the fourth layer from the bottom of the stack in the OSI model, and it is, consequently, layer 4. The purpose of the transport layer is to provide end-to-end communications for individual applications that are network aware. These applications access the transport layer via a socket on a computer system. And a socket is simply a software-defined component that provides an interface to the transport layer protocols. And the computer's operating system, via some type of sockets library, provides the socket capabilities. Transport layer protocols can be divided into connection-oriented and connectionless forms. Connection-oriented protocols establish and maintain communications channels from one endpoint of the connection to the other endpoint, and among other things, they ensure that messages arrive in order. Connectionless protocols, on the other hand, function a lot like datagrams at the network layer. These single messages can arrive in any order or be lost or otherwise shuffled about. That brings us to the subject of reliability. Reliable protocols provide mechanisms for detecting delivery failure and automatically recover from dropped or duplicated messages at the network layer, either by removing the duplicates or by dropping or by resending dropped messages. Unreliable protocols, on the other hand, do absolutely no type of detection of delivery failure. They simply send the message, and if it gets there, great, and if it doesn't get there, great, they don't really care. Those messages can be dropped, those messages can be duplicated, and there's no recovery automatically. Transport layer protocols may also provide or not provide congestion and flow management. With congestion control, a transport layer protocol will avoid further overloading an already saturated link with more traffic. An example would be surfing the internet during extremely busy times of day. A congestion control protocol, or a protocol supporting congestion control, would detect that there was quite a bit of traffic and would back off transmissions a little bit so as not to overload or aggravate the traffic situation. It's a bit like drivers slowing down in heavy traffic instead of trying to floor it and running into the cars in front of them. Flow control, on the other hand, avoids overwhelming the receiver with more messages than it can handle in a short time period. The receivers on some devices are actually quite small. There might be memory-limited embedded devices, and sending too much data at one time can overwhelm them and cause them to lock up or simply start discarding messages. Flow control mitigates this problem. So we have two extremely common layer 4 protocols, or transport layer protocols, in widespread use. Those are the Transmission Control Protocol, or TCP, and the User Datagram Protocol, or UDP. The Transmission Control Protocol, or TCP, is a connection-oriented protocol. It provides ordered, stream-oriented communication, meaning whatever information is put into the stream at one end should come out of the stream intact at the other end. It is a reliable protocol, so it will automatically handle situations in which messages or packets at the underlying network layer are dropped. And it provides congestion and flow control using a fairly complicated sliding window mechanism. TCP applications include connections to web servers, such as web browsing, email servers, and most types of file transfer. The User Datagram Protocol, on the other hand, is a connectionless protocol. It's an unreliable protocol in which the messages might or might not arrive. Now you might be thinking, well, what's the advantage of using the User Datagram Protocol over simply using a network packet directly? And the answer is simply simplicity for the implementation code. The User Datagram Protocol provides the ability for multiple different applications to share the same network layer and have messages destined for different applications sent to the appropriate application. If you're simply to use the network layer directly without using User Datagram Protocol, each application would have to filter every incoming message to determine if that message was relevant to that particular application. So UDP still does provide some advantages, even though connection orientation and reliability are not among them. And without connection orientation, flow control and congestion control are simply not possible. There are a number of applications of UDP. Video games use UDP extensively for position updates of players and NPCs in the game. Most voice and video applications use UDP simply because it has lower overhead than TCP, and because a lost packet or a lost message here and there isn't going to make massively problematic impacts on the voice or video. If a frame of a video gets dropped or part of a frame of a video gets dropped, most people aren't even going to notice, and even if they do notice, they're just going to kind of shrug and not worry about it. Other protocols that make the internet work, including DNS and DHCP that make most local networking systems work, are also built on top of UDP. So these transport layer protocols are in wide use and have different purposes, but together improve our ability to use the internet.